Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to ESL 1 Cologne 2014. Got a fantastic crowd in here right now at Gamescom 2014, here to witness some CS history as we go towards the grand final in our $250,000 championship with one quarterfinal down. Let's take a quick look at the bracket and show you exactly how things have played out. If you missed the first game of the day, and how dare you miss the first game of the day earlier on, we saw an absolutely fantastic three-map game. In the end, Fnatic just about squeezing past Na'Vi. So one down, three to go, and next up, we have another nail-biting quarterfinal in store for us. Two teams who have battled it out before and are desperate to put their name on this trophy. First up on stage, a team who have been consistently top four in recent form, blasted their way in Gfinity, and have recently pulled off some fantastic victories against NIP as well. Please welcome Team Dignitas. And they go up against a team of ragtag players, some might say, the dirty underdogs, who had an absolutely stunning group set of play. Please welcome Epsilon. We'll let the players get settled into their seats, and in the meantime, let's go over to the analysis desk once more with Sir Scoots.
Thank you, Red Eye. We have said goodbye to Top Gun, but we're joined by the one and only MBK. It's bittersweet. It's always great to have you giving your commentary and here on the desks, but obviously that means that you're not playing today.
Yep.
So thanks for stopping by and helping us. And again, you're very familiar with one of the teams, unfortunately, yes. The Dignitas.
They're very long time rivals against us, and we faced them so many times, especially Fetish, because there has been many players changes, but they're an excellent team. They have very, very strong maps, really great innovations in the game. Facing them, Epsilon, one of the best French team at the moment, they had an excellent group stage. It's going to be a crazy game once again.
Richard, you've done some due diligence here with some matchups. Walk me through what you got there on all your notes.
Okay, well, I mean, don't think it's any surprise. Nathan knows all about it. The key to this game, I think, is going to be the map selection, because Dignitas absolutely hands down have a repertoire of maps that they can beat anybody on. Nuke, you may remember that game from games such as yesterday,
just a bit.
Where they 16-1 Titan, and you know we know that's never easy to recover from. But they are probably the best team in the world on Nuke right now. I don't think that's an exaggeration. I don't know if you'd agree with that, would you?
Well, they're definitely in top three best teams. Yeah. You know, it's always like you're gonna win one game and like lose the other one because you're gonna adapt to the strategies and how the other team is gonna play. But definitely, they played an extremely strong game yesterday against us, and they totally deserve the victory.
And, you know, the last five times they played it, they'd won four. I think the last team to beat them on Nuke, funnily enough, was NIP. But NIP didn't feel confident playing them on Nuke at Gfinity. They eliminated it. I think we're probably going to see Nuke eliminated here. I think that's what Epsilon are going to have to do to keep up with them.
I think Epsilon is just naturally not such a strong team on Nuke. They're not, like, they prefer open maps where they can make, you know, Kirishima, Foxio, Shoxi talk with their worst kill. And that's what they're going to try to do, I think. And I don't think we're going to see Nuke in this best of three.
Yeah, I think you're right there. Now, where it gets interesting is Dust 2. Both of these teams are quite good on Dust 2. Dignitas have won it the last four times they played it. They've beaten some, you know, I mean, obviously they played the Australians on it the other day. I don't know how much of a test that was. Sorry, Top Gun. But, you know, they've beaten some really good teams. They beat ESG. They humbled them at Gfinity. They beat Mouse Sports. Going back, they played in the Scan Invitational, which was the Dignitas Cup, and they beat NIP in the final on Dust 2. They're very comfortable on that map. But then again, so are Epsilon. They're very good at that. It plays to their strengths. You know, you've got someone like Shox who plays this kind of wide open game where you can just run around and frag, and Dust 2's tailor-made for that. So they've only lost once on Dust 2 in the last few times they've played it as well. I don't know what you think about that matchup potentially between those two, which team's better?
Epsilon showed extremely good things on Dust 2. At DreamHack Valencia, they won 16-0 over Herazos. That was probably like one of the most remarkable things of the tournament. And they're just excellent research players. I would say like they have Fox years since 1 month, I think, in the team. And he's going to be a great advantage in such a map because the sniper is so important in this game on Dust 2. So Dignitas, they obviously have a lot of experience, you know, on that map as well, and they are very strong. So, I mean, they're surely against Vox Seminar, and like everyone is kind of underestimating the Australians, but they are actually like in practice. They last time they came here at Katowice, they were very good and very surprising, you know. So it shows that Dignitas are really on point on the game, and I really can't wait to see, you know, the sniper duels and even what Fetish and Shocks can bring to the game.
So, I mean, so that's one of them. And then I think the other map that's maybe going to be key here, it's going to be a toss-up between, I'd say, Mirage or Inferno. Now, Epsilon love Inferno. They play lots of it, but they don't always win on it, which is very strange. At Gfinity, they played it four times in a row. That was their last four maps in the tournament, and they lost two of those. No, three of those, actually, which is very strange. And they lost to teams like I Buy Power. You know, they beat Infused on it, but they lost to, like, London Conspiracy, teams that they realistically should be beating. So I think that's going to be interesting if that map comes up. They're obviously relatively confident on it. They smashed Hellraisers on it the other day. We saw that, 16-1. Yep. They've got strats on this map. But then again, so have Team Dignitas. We know that Dignitas can play this map. Now, they lost a Gfinity against Virtus Pro, but they beat NIP on this map recently. They beat Titan on this map at Gfinity. So Dignitas are comfortable with Inferno, but Epsilon obviously feel that this is a map for them. So that's very interesting as well. I think, literally, these are two evenly matched teams if the terrain is right for the teams that plays at their strengths. I probably plump for Dignitas being the stronger team then.
Yeah, definitely. I think Dignitas have got more experience as players first and as a team. So it's got, like, as you said, exactly, like, regarding the maps, it's going to be an excellent matchup.
And, we actually got the videos here on stage. Yeah, so let's see what we're doing here.
Let's have a look. Let's peer in.
Let's see.
We need to get that cameraman to sit right on his shoulder. Put him up.
Well, I'm almost sure about Epsilon Veto Nuke. And I would say that Dignitas vetoed a Cobblestone because I don't think they're very confident on it. And I think Epsilon picked Dust 2. Yeah, Epsilon picked Dust 2, which is a map they actually
want to play. We expected it to come up, exactly. Both teams can win that map.
It's going to be excellent to see that as a first map. And Inferno is going to be second map. So that was map we were expecting. And now the third map is going to be Overpass. Is it?
Is that actually happening?
I think it is Overpass as a third map.
Well, I'll tell you this. Yeah. That's interesting because that will put Fetish on tilt straight away. He did not want to play Overpass this tournament. He was very vocal about saying what a terrible map it was. He didn't think it was suitable for competition. I wonder if that's going to maybe give Epsilon a little bit of a psychological edge if they go into that game.
Well, definitely. I mean, Epsilon are ready on every single map right there. The seventh map, they play them, and they are ready to play any team on them. So, we should, take one map at a time because that's too, first of all, it's going to be a very tough game, and like Dignitas chose to start CD, I think, which became pretty classic now. Although it's like the hardest side you like to start CD because on the Terry side you can just roll on and like it's easier to come back. Very, very interesting matchup, and you can see Dignitas, they look very prepared. Like Fetish knows what they are gonna do. You can see that it's like this team revolves around Fetish a lot. Like he's gonna be the strat caller, he is beating the game. And he's got four amazing roll skills with him. I mean, Fetish is excellent as well. Obviously, he just wrecked us on Nuke yesterday, you know. But
I mean, I've said like many, many times on many casts, I mean, Henrik has won a big tournament, a sizable tournament every year since 2005. That's all you need to know about him as a captain. He is good enough to put a team together that's going to win tournaments. And you can see that they're up, they're on their feet, they're talking. One of the things that we talked about at Gfinity, and you'll know better than us because you played with these guys, you know these guys. But I thought there was times in Epsilon where they didn't seem to be a solid unit. They seemed to maybe argue a little bit in between rounds and Shock seemed a little bit distant from the rest of the team.
Yeah, that's 100% true statement. At Gfinity, I know they had some troubles with folks are coming into the team, but you can see, you can just look at them right now. They're just sitting on the computer. They know what they're going to do. They're totally, you know, up to the game, and they have their game plan in mind.
they're very calm and they look extremely confident, which is pretty surprising for such a young team. Let's cut it that way. And like Shoxi taking the lead since few weeks, I think. It's really weird to see them that confident coming into this matchup. But you know, Dust 2 is going to be a really open map, I think, and any team can take it right here.
Yeah, I really don't know how to call this one, and I think you're absolutely right. I think it's going to be all about these sort of duels that we have in mid. Who do you think is going to go mid for Dignitas? Do you think it'll be Device?
I think they're switching the sniper. Like, Dignitas have got this this possibility of playing on several snipers. They've got Fetish that plays with it. They're pre on some very casual positions. Yeah. Device as well, so...
I mean, I've noticed when I've been casting them in the past is Device, if they want to play aggressive and they're confident they can beat the other AWPer, they let Device do it. If they want to play passive, they put Henrik in the middle and Fetish will AWP and play really passive and just sort of watch it. So I think that's going to give us a clear indication about the statement of intent, whether they're really confident of winning on Dust 2 or whether they're going to show Epsilon the respect we should probably be showing them right now.
That being said, we're ready to rock and roll.
Awesome.
New caster team this time. It's the one and only Tossbot and joined by Steel from iBuyPower. Guys, take it away.
Scott, thank you very much. Josh, welcome to the analysis desk. Let's quickly handle your tournament, your thoughts on everything that's gone on this weekend for you.
Well, everyone knows that we went out in 9th to 12th place, which wasn't exactly ideal for us, but we still had a lot of fun and we learned a lot from the event, from the experience of being here, and we're happy to kind of make the adjustments going forwards.
Very politically correct answer, if I may say so myself. So looking at this game, what have you learned in the past few days about these two teams?
Dignitas is a team that on their counter-terror side, they are just a force. They always pick up, you know, 10, 11, maybe even 12 rounds. Well, against Titan, we saw them pick up 14-1, I believe it was.
How does a team become so counter-terrorist focused? We've been talking about this now for 2-3 tournaments. They're just so strong on CT. Yeah. How does it happen?
You need to have really good rotations, really good chemistry and teamwork. So you need to be set up in a certain way where you can rotate back and forth quickly, but you have to have trust in your teammates, and you need to be able to know when to rotate and where to rotate to. And it feels like these players, they've all been playing together for quite a while, and they just know exactly where they need to go and when. And they get the good crossfires going on. They get the trade kills when it needs to happen. But they also have the individual skill. We saw Dupree yesterday making huge frags, huge plays. Same with Device. Same with just everyone. They all have that talent.
Quickly, before we start, your thoughts on Epsilon.
Epsilon, I mean, it's the Shox factors. They're hit or miss. If Shox is on, they're winning. If Shox is off, they're losing. It all comes down to him, but this is Shox's map, definitely.
Yeah, Dust 2 is a map that, to quote Thorin, you know, you can't be bad on, because you got to play it.
Yeah.
So it also can't be your strongest map, because everyone's pretty good at it. So let's see, as Epsilon... starting on the T side, which you knew when the mouse was hovered over which side do you want during the veto side, the Dignitas were automatically going to pick CT, which, as MBK articulated, is for other reasons as well, but Fetish will sit deep. He has GMX ready to come his way, but Epsilon uncommitted right now. They'll wait till SF can join this fight before really making a push. Now see FXO, who's had a good tournament this Cologne, particularly in the group stages, has really shone through, and that's what Epsilon are going to need. They're going to need players like FXO to rise to the level of Shox. They can't be dependent on one man. And Kiyoshima also had a great tournament for them. So if Epsilon can continue that heat, we'll see. They're about to make their entrance now. It's Kiyoshima that will be on board with this. Device spies all of them coming his way. Zipnix helps him out, gets the headshot onto FXO, and now it'll be Device going big with the help of Fetish. It's three frags for Dignitas before Kiyoshima gets one back. They are in on that site, but it won't be long before Zipnix joins in on the fun, and that will be 5-1. Great start for Team Dignitas.
And that was an example of a perfect counter-terrorist hold there from Dignitas. They played basically a 3A, 2B setup. They played extremely passive, but they played like a crossfire. So if the player on the A bomb site was getting pushed, there's a player at the car to help support from that angle. And there was another player at long who could come over and support as well. So they had basically three people watching for Epsilon's push there. And Epsilon, if they're not making their frags, they're going to run into big trouble. And that's exactly what Dignitas is going to be doing the entire game, and that's what they're really strong at.
Anything different Epsilon could have done in that situation?
Epsilon, I mean, they were given full middle control. They were given full cat control. They had all of the map. They didn't really scout around. They just executed directly into Dignitas's push. So instead of, you know, just executing right away, maybe they can peek out and kind of figure out what Dignitas's setup is basically happening. But maybe Epsilon thought that Dignitas was set up in a certain way from beforehand, and they just chose to do that because it was a counter strat. But I mean, they just ran straight into the stack, straight into their deaths.
Yeah, we didn't have much time to talk about Epsilon before the game. Shox, awesome player.
Yes.
But let's go through the other four players, what they bring to this team.
Okay, well, we had GMX, and GMX actually used to be the strat caller for them, but I believe Shox has now picked up that role, as well as his insanely good entry style. So this is going to probably give the team a more loose approach to the game, which means that they're going to go for a lot more pickoffs, try to make it a 5 versus 4, really aggressive style with the rifles. And then, as we saw there on their pistol round, they will fall back into doing those sight executions where they line up, they do their smokes, they do their flashes, and they push in together as a group. But we're going to see a lot looser style, and we're going to see probably Shoxi trying to do aggressive pushes on when they get to counter terror side as well.
Now let's talk about the two teams' kind of, you know, weaknesses, if you will. Dignitas are germanly efficient at being brutal, pushing through the early stages of the tournament. They never falter in the early stages of the tournament. But when it gets to the knockout stage, and you can go all the way back to DreamHack Winter last year for when they were Copenhagen Wolves in the old lineup, they look good early stages. They were a surprising team. But then they come up into the quarters or the finals and knockout stages, something doesn't work for them. On the other side, Epsilon, horrendously inconsistent. When they're great, they're, you know, they could be one of the best teams. But that doesn't happen often enough.
Yeah, so Dignitas, I guess, if everyone was watching the Cloud9 game yesterday, they choked. They had the lead. They got the pistol on both halves. They got eco'd the second round. They were down 1-5, I believe, and then they brought it back 10-5, and then they won the pistol. They should have just basically won out from there, or at least got to 14 rounds, but then they just collapsed. They couldn't close out the game, and they basically just got annihilated. So I think maybe some of it could be pressure, some of it could be just the nerves being on the main stage, because we see them online they have no problems closing out the tournaments. We've seen them beat NIP online in a couple of occasions, but when it gets to the quarterfinals, semifinals, and finals, they just have that issue of closing out the games in those high pressure situations.
Talk, you've been in those situations yourself. Talk to us how that happens, because if we go back just one weekend to Gfinity, they were the best team in the tournament by a mile, and somehow VODS Pro just made it look easy.
Yeah, I mean, every tournament is going to be different. It depends on the crowd. It depends on just your personal just feelings, your personal confidence going into the game. If you're feeling a little bit stressed individually, that's going to play, you know, on your mind. And then maybe your teammate notices that you're not feeling up to par, and then they get a little bit worried for you, and then it just plays like a spiral effect. So I think everyone just needs to be confident. Everyone needs to be bringing their A game to the table, and just kind of ignore that the fact that, you know, if you lose, ignore the fact that, you know, thousands of people are watching you, and just focus on the game at hand.
Hundreds of thousands of people are
watching.
Hundreds
of thousands of people.
No pressure. Anyway, we're going to get this game back underway. Team Dignitas having won the pistol. Will be favored for this. Epsilon going to run 4 CZs, and GMX is really going to bring the party this round. More Famous is on that dig side. On board with Shox, as he will be the man to make the first move.
So it looks like right here, Dignitas is doing the exact same setup they did on their pistol, and it looks like Epsilon's kind of like poking out and seeing what setup Dignitas is doing this round. And it looks like they've kind of figured out they're playing the passive setup they did on pistol. They're going to try mid to B this round.
SF leading that push. It's going to be AZ who sees action first. Dupree will get himself an assist courtesy of Zipnix, and SF comes in and avenges. Kiyoshima gets himself the frag, and Epsilon have the B bomb site. Zipnix going to have to come around and try and prevent the inevitable, but against four Frenchmen, this is not going to be easy. FXYO goes down. Zipnix gets his second, and Dignitas now begin to make that retake, but Kiyoshima not done without a fight. Low health on Kiyoshima, though, and he will be down. Shots left standing, and he finishes off Fetish, and that's an excellent round from Epsilon.
That was almost perfect. The execution from Epsilon, they kind of actually felt out what Dignitas was doing, what they didn't do on the pistol round. They found out that Dignitas was playing the passive setup. Mid to B was the perfect counter to that. Dignitas was so cut off from the rest of the team. They had two players at B trapped, the other three players over at A. Epsilon kind of just went in, 5 versus 2, and then they traded down the kills. They got into 1 versus 1, and Shox got the better of the last Dignitas player. So that's exactly how they want to turn this around.
On board was SF now. He and Shox combined to open up that B bomb site. Dignitas have only two men left with CZs. And Fexio helps himself to frag number 4. Device, the only one left standing. GMX has gone down. And Device will get himself another frag. Nice play from him. But, no armor in 3 very angry Epsilon players, including Shox, who's already got 2 this round. You don't see Device going much further. Now, Tucker's old Device will go a little bit further, gets himself a hat trick there, and managed to make this expensive, and will run in the end to Kiyoshima. Now, talk to us about the speed at which Epsilon changed up there. To go charging in on pistol round with the playbook, and then to make a quick diversion to be more of a read and react attack on round 2, that's a very quick turnaround.
That is a very quick turnaround. I think that's a lot to do with the Strackle, I guess it's Strox in this case, kind of trying to figure out when you're with pistols, you want to kind of go against the least resistance. So at the start of the round, Dignitas had a 2-1-2 setup. They had one player watching mid, two players B, two players A. But then they moved Zitnix back to A bomb site, and then they played the 3-2 setup, which is what they were doing on the pistol round. Once Strox realized that, once they scattered up Cat, that's when they decided to hit the mid to B. So it was the players individually getting information, gathering information, relaying it back to the strat caller, and then they made the adjustment from there.
Dupree down in B. He's had a busy opening 4 rounds. He's still not ready to leave. And they've lost SF, and Kiyoshima is not in the best of health, but they will move in with FX. He's wondering where anyone on the A site will be. Zipnik's completely caught unawares. And Fetish now being distracted will allow that man to go a little further. And there is FXO going to get himself. Oh, Fetish! What a hit! FXO down. And that really was his opening. As Dignitas will be able to hold on to that A site. Now, GMX is going to come in. He will lead the push. Great nade. Finishes off onto Fetish. Just clipped him right on the head. And now GMX needs to complete onto Zipnix. As he will do with the headshot. And that allows the bomb to move in. It's Device and AZ. And the CZ, well, I was going to say not the weapon for range, but he does manage to chop off 70 points of health. And look at those Epsilon health bars, actually. Very low. This is an opportunity for Dignitas. If they can get close up, work the angles with the CZ, they will be able to retake. But headshots, dispatch of everything. And AZ now 1-on-3, not going to be able to fulfill his dream.
So while AZ is just kind of looking for his probably exit kill, I just want to talk about the last 2 rounds. So the first eco round that Dignitas did, they did a 2-1-2, and they pushed long and they pushed B tunnels at the same time. And Epsilon did the same anti-eco setup both times. One round, or both times, they went 3 people B, 1 person watched for mid push, 1 person looked for the long push. Once they got the kills over B, they knew, okay, we can just go B. The players here are dead. Let's go there. And I think it was Device that got a couple of kills and picked up the Galil, but he was run down. That time, this last round, Dignitas played passively. They played the same 2-1-2 style, but they played in the bomb sites. Once Epsilon saw that they couldn't get those easy initial kills, FXO walked up Cat into the A bomb site, called for his teammates, hey guys, it's clear, I don't see anyone, I'm on the bomb site, come A. We saw the Epsilon players rotating back to the A bomb site through T-spawn, and that's the kind of loose play style that this team is now playing with, where you have an individual player gather information, kind of make a call, and get the team to fall back to his position once he has, you know, an advantage. Obviously, if FAXO died there, but the rest of the team was able to pick up the kills. We saw Shox get a nice 1 kill there. Sorry, 1 click. We saw a player get a kill on one of the spawn players. So, and the nade onto the A bomb site. So this is all great individual play coming out of Epsilon off of that individual just information coming out.
Call it a knowledge-led attack.
Knowledge-led attack? Yeah, maybe.
Now, on the Dignitas side, you know, hard to really analyze their defense given that they've been on CZs for two rounds and a pistol on one of them. They've only had that one gun round, which they lost.
Yes. So, I mean, they're probably going to stick with the same setup. When you get the setup and you have the full weapons, it's a really good setup. The enemy team can't attack the A-bomb site. It's really difficult. And then that forces them to go mid to B. Once you know that they're going mid to B, you have a great reaction from the B players just to lock down the doors, lock down the windows.
And there are the crowd ready to cheer on their team. Like, guys, who are you cheering for? Let's make some noise. There we go. Now, it's hard to know. In the last game, I was sat out there for the Navi game, and there were definitely a lot of cheers for Navi. I felt there was a Navi favored crowd. This side, would the Germans cheer for the French? I doubt it. They must be Dignitas fans, surely.
Well, we see a Nip fan there. Yeah. Forest, easy skins, easy life. Easy knife, easy life.
Titan t-shirt out there. Seen a lot of the team jerseys out there. Seen a fair few Nip and Titan jerseys.
And Cloud9.
And Cloud9. Not seen an iBuyPal one. Sorry,
Josh. In a world. One man, one desire. No, I have my power jerseys.
You keep going.
That's all I know. That's the only thing I know. I can't do the rest. In a world that was underwater.
Josh Nissan, everyone.
Josh Nissan.
Hero of the people. So, something up with Epsilon at the moment. And they'll be keen to hold on to what has been an excellent start to this. It will be Dust 2 and then Inferno, and if we need it, it will be Overpass.
That's a bit of a coin flip map, in my opinion.
Now, what are your thoughts? What are your thoughts on the kind of general pull and veto system? There's been a lot of debate on the veto system, random element to it. In on one hand, you have the, we are expanding that pool, we are getting more. On the other hand, you know, you players like certain maps and they like a certain amount of control.
So, personally, I don't like it. But the logic behind it is all the tournaments during the group stages, because it's best of one, you want to get the most balanced map possible. You don't want to start T-side nuke and then go out in the group stage. So usually we see Dust 2, we see Inferno. And I guess what a lot of the Valve developers, for one, saw is that, you know, Inferno's being overplayed. None of the other maps are being played in the group stages. How can we make other maps be played? Make it random. So this means that instead of having Inferno played like 10 times and, you know, another map played one or zero times, now you have an even split where it's like all played 5 times each.
Which is a great argument.
It is a great argument, but for best of one CS, I mean, you just never know. It's upsets happen all the time, and then there needs to be room for the bounce back. In the second and third maps, teams can, you know, fix their mistakes and kind of come back into the game. But if it's just the one map and you make your mistakes, that's it. That's the end of the road for you.
Let's talk about the rest of the day that we've got coming up.
Sure.
Right up next, VODS Pro will be taken to the stage. Your thoughts on their game?
VODS Pro against us. They annihilated us. The thing about VODS Pro is that once they're down to their tournament life, they are unstoppable. We saw that at EMS1 Katowice. They just plowed through NIP in the finals like it was nothing. They did the exact same thing to us yesterday in the group stages after they dropped to Fnatic in, I believe this is overtime. So once they get to that point where they're just like, it's do or die, they just get on a roll and they keep rolling.
Yeah, I was talking to Taz right off to Gfinity, yeah. Having a few drinks, and he was saying, actually, he was infuriated at the whole of Gfinity because no one was talking, there was nothing there, and just screamed at the players, said, guys, I can't do this on my own. Where the hell are you? Can't hear you. And he was talking about how, you know, there's still a young team, still some, you know, in some of the players, and still trying to galvanize them. Mm-hmm. Suddenly, he then had 5 strat callers to help him out, and that's why they won Gfinity.
Yeah.
And it's finding that voice, and he's trying to encourage all of those players to keep talking and talking and talking, because with it comes confidence, even if they don't necessarily choose the strat that they're going to go for.
Yeah. That's a great thing to have within a team. It just means that you're just so much more dynamic as a team. You're not locked into one person's, you know, field of view. So your strat caller might get tunnel vision, and then what you need is the other players to kind of see something, pull them out of it, give them information, feed them information, feed them an idea. And then that way, you know, if you're going to call a strat that might not work and your teammate's like, well, hey, we can do this instead and it'll get us around, boom. You know, you'll never really get stuck where you're just like, what do we do?
Then last game of the day, NIP versus Cloud9.
Yes.
I think everyone's like, that's the one we're waiting for. just be about time when some of the Americans will be awake as well. Yeah. You know, it's going to be great.
It should be a good game. I think this has happened four times where they've met in the quarterfinals.
It was DreamHack Window was the last one, Complexity and AP.
Yeah, I think they met at ESEA LAN in the first round, in the upper round. Actually, they were Complexity at the time, Cloud9 was Complexity, and they actually took the better of NIP. So we have seen some back and forth, but generally speaking, NIP has been doing better in these matchups. And
but is this the same NIP?
Is this the same NIP? I think so. They're on fire. Like, they've had some shaky results. ESEA LAN, Gfinity, they didn't do so well, but in the practice over this past, you know, couple weeks, they've been really strong. In this tournament, they lost to Epsilon on Kabul, but they've still been really strong. And when you look at the big picture, I mean, NIP was on a vacation, now they're back. They mean business. It's a major. They mean business.
We are just about ready to get this game underway. Speaking of vacations, under this camera and lights, we look like we've both been on vacation. Look at that.
Yeah,
I've never looked so brand in town. My usual Sheldon Cooper look is gone. It's great. Anyway, we are ready to get going. Slight tangent. In fact, this round's been live for a little bit.
Yeah, we're about 50 seconds left in the round. Can already see what Epsilon is thinking about doing, and that's going to be swinging over to this side of the map, kind of baiting out a reaction from Dignitas first. So we will see the push here coming in shortly, but
here we go. It'll be Yazy, he'll see action first. And actually, in doing so, putting him in this position, they've surrendered the site itself, and he's going to have to be the one to come back in, but there's Dupree. Double frag, Zipnix helps out with number three, and Dignitas have a 5-on-2, which they will convert to a 5-on-1. Kiyoshima, last man standing. And he gets himself the first with the frag onto Dupree, but it's always a tall order.
That was insane. Dignitas there, they forfeit the B bomb site completely. Epsilon got into the bomb site with four players, completely uncontested. They threw a fake at middle. Dignitas players were playing outside the bomb site. How did they die? How did they die? I don't know. How did they die? That was an amazing hold from Dignitas from outside of the bomb site. I don't know how Epsilon was able to lose that round.
And now it is Epsilon on the CZ round. It is 2-3, Dignitas. Target score for Dignitas at the start of this match versus what's the target score? We'll come back in a second as it'll be GMX pushing in, getting himself the first frag onto Fetish. And Fetish had a rotten first five rounds. Zipnix gets the frag onto Shox, and Device will watch the crossover with the AWP, helped by Zipnix and Dupree. And Dignitas should mow down the remaining Epsilon players. So 3-3.
So Dust 2, it was Epsilon's map pick. So you would expect that they feel confident on it. They want to win the map. Dignitas, they picked CT side. Generally speaking, they'd want to get around 10 rounds. Being that it's Dust 2, you know, they could settle with 9-8 rounds. They got the pistol round. They'll want to get as many rounds as possible. Now, when it comes down to it, at the end of this half, 10-5 should be reasonable. 10-5 they can work with.
Well, let's see. Epsilon this time will move in. Shox with the frag onto Dupree, and Epsilon find themselves a man to the good. From here, Dignitas retreat. They'll just sit there 2-2 in the site, waiting for the next move from Epsilon, who sit a little uncommitted on either side. See if they can get one more so they can load up that one site. But at the moment, they've not found it. Shox is down to 9 health with that exchange onto Dupree. And it'll be Fetish, who has always been right in the center of where an attack's gone or not been able to get involved. He'll be a little bit frustrated after the opening six. Now Fetish will see the peak and retreat back, sound the alarm. And here we go. Fetish pokes up and is under a whole world of trouble. Somehow still alive. They've not been able to quite wipe him out. And Zipnix has now come in. And Zipnix has had enough time to pick up two big frags. Fetish gets in there as well. And Device finishes off the route.
That was an amazing hold from Dignitas. We saw there, Epsilon was doing exactly what I said they would do at the beginning of the game. Shox, they would get a pick, they'd make it 5 versus 4, they'd regroup, they would execute together. Right there, we saw from Dignitas, two players at A, two players at B. Other side of the map. those two A players were able to shut down the four terrors coming out of long, throwing flashes, smokes, nades, all at the pick guy, and they were able to pick up two apiece at A. That is incredible teamwork, that is incredible patience and just composure.
Talk about the role of Fanish there, because he had so many times where he could have showed himself, could have gone for something. Ooh, Kiyoshima's going to get himself a frag there onto Zipnix, and Epsilon not quite ready to ride off an eco here as SF is, man, and we'll lose two Dignitas players here, but Device comes in with two of his own. GMX now joins the fun. Epsilon, low health, have two left to find. It's Dupree and AZ as that bomb does go down. And Dupree quickly about turns and drops two players. Then AZ finishes off the job, but four men down and a bomb plant, not a terrible eco.
Again, it's about composure, and Dignitas has loads of it right now. So going back to the round you were talking about, Fetish baited out Zipnix. Zipnix was in the pit, taking all of the attention from the Epsilon players towards him. They had a smoke down that was at the corner blocking off Fetish's view. Instead of Fetish just running through it and whatever, he waited for the Epsilon players to look at Zipnix in the pit. Then he came out and got two kills from the side. So that was perfect, like a perfect way to bait your teammate in a productive way. And then that round, that was this last round, great way for, you know, just to explain the composure that Dignitas has. Device getting pushed from Cat and Long at the same time, still able to pick up two kills. Like, you need to be really, like, stone cold to be able to do that.
It is 5-3 Dignitas. They've won two in a row now. Yeah, so in fact, going back, they've won more than that. They're on a bit of a roll.
We're just setting up slow. It's actually a nice change of pace from Epsilon, just taking it slow, taking map control. And Dignitas is playing, you know, the same way they've been playing all game, just playing their game, kind of making Epsilon execute into them. So for the first minute of each round, it's basically going to be the same thing, slow working.
It's going to be shocks to open up the fragging. Zipnix goes down. He'll now lead that charge. Fetish is desperate to get involved in the action, but he has got reinforcements as well there. As we'll see Device dropped by Kiyoshima. There's Fetish. Kiyoshima loses his head. Fetish goes for the second. GMX just completely stranded there. And I wonder whether he had an issue as bomb does go down, though. We're on a 3-on-3 with an AWP and an auto sniper yet to play their hands. As Infexio will move in. There's Fetish with AZ now charging. AZ had a great game, but there's the commentator curse. Walk straight into SF, and FXO gets the next one. And Dupree will say, that's enough for me. And out he goes from that site.
Yeah, and he's got quite an expensive weapon here, so saving is definitely the right idea at this point. And Epsilon, I mean, they played that perfectly. Shox got the opening kill. They pushed their way onto the A-bomb site. Dignitas fell back. They kind of walked down long A and kind of played for the retake. I think GMX there was just slightly outside the smoke on, was it Fetish's point of view? But on his point of view, he was still like gray screen. So even though it looks like he's outside the smoke, he couldn't see a thing, and that's why he was just standing there and got killed.
5-4, Dig, lose that round. But again, each round so expensive. Not much money in either bank at this moment in time. Every round almost forcing a save. But this is going to be Dignitas to, well, they lose immediately 80 points of health onto Dupree, who sets himself up. As we talk about what you were mentioning earlier about finding some information, Dignitas are very good at offering up very little.
Yeah, I mean, they're saving as we can see right now. They still have basically a smoke and two flashes on almost every player, and it's, you know, 30 seconds into the round. They just used one of their smokes. So they're good at, like, delaying and making sure that when Epsilon does their real push, that's when they're not going to be able to actually do any damage because they're pushing through a smoke or they're all blind and completely a white screen. Still, at a minute, neither team's made a play. Both teams have smokes and flashes for the executes and the fakes. So we don't know what's going on at this point. And I think Epsilon and Dignitas are doing an equally good job of actually getting that information. But we saw a Device there actually getting a really good push up, and that's kind of not what they normally do, getting pushed up on Cat and getting a kill there.
FXO looking for Zipnix here, and as he's flashed, Zipnix jumps out, pounces, takes the opportunity in the frag. Dupree follows in with one to SF, and there is only one man left standing now. It's Kiyoshima, and he is going in 1-on-5. They know where he is, and they will look to dispatch of him. He wants to go down with something out of this, but in the end, it isn't going to happen. The firing squad dispatches, and Dignitas are rolling now.
That was huge damage from that last... Was it SF? At the, Kiyoshima at the end there. He almost killed two players, and Dupree was at the back of the bomb site with really low health. Even if he, you know, he's not necessarily going to win the round, but even if he picked off one, two, maybe even three of the players there, like, that would have helped the team out in terms of economy. As we see, Dignitas, they kept all five members alive. They're able to bank up. And if they keep banking up, you know, sooner on, or later on in the half, they're not going to have any issues buying up guns every round. But Epsilon, we see them struggling right now.
Talk us through this buy from Epsilon. SF has bought maybe just to equalize out the money on the side, or...?
If I could see the money right now, I'd definitely be able to kind of figure out why that was the case. We can see SF, $2,300 in the bank. He still has more money than, you know, the rest of his team. So if he dies and they lose this round, he's still going to be on the same buy as the rest of his team. So the logic behind it is, may as well, you know, increase our chances at winning this eco.
Here we go. Device is going to push in and gets the frag. AZ joins the fun, and we are seeing Dictus just... cleaning out this eco, perhaps with a...
it's
uninterrupted, but there we go, yes. Kiyoshima will get that 7-4 dig.
And that team kill actually cost them a tiny bit of money. Not only do they have to, you know, rebuy, but Device is going to be low on money himself. But again, Epsilon, I mean, they really need to start picking up rounds. Even if they get one, maybe two more, they're going to be happy with this half. They lost the pistol, and Dignitas, their counter-terracides are really strong. It's their terracides that are kind of, you know, up and down, inconsistent. So Epsilon looking quite strong, actually, at the moment. Even though it's 7-4, you're thinking, eh, it's not ideal. It's actually, at this point, it's not bad.
The youthful optimism of Steel. Kiyoshima in mid, waiting for AZ to show himself, and Sipnix will sit. And, you know, in some games you'll see a Roma, a Get Right, who will do exactly what Sipnix is doing here, but then go further. Dignitas aren't built that way. They're built to maybe find an early pick and retreat, but only a handful of times. They'll quite happily sit further and further back, and be more than happy to work on a retake scenario.
Yeah. And this is actually the first time we were seeing Dignitas do this setup. And I think the tell was the smoke on Cat. And we're going to see Epsilon. They don't want to actually do anything without Cat control. So that's why they're waiting so long right now. They're waiting for this Cat control to be taken before they go into their strat. They know they can't actually execute anything while Zipnix is in this position. Scratch that.
Shock's going to lead the charge as he pushes up now. He's got one right in front of him. It's going to be AZ he looks for. Shock turns around the corner. SF helps him out. Kiyoshima has a frag too, but we've lost two of Epsilon as the bomb site becomes French territory. Dupree, though, going to play a massive role. Poking in the back, drops SF, and now Dupree just firing in towards that smoke. Does get himself the kill with the help of Device, and the bomb will be defused.
That was actually a great play by Dupree. We actually missed it, but I saw it on the radar and through the X-ray. He was actually caught by himself in the B bomb site on that push from Epsilon. He walked into the smoke, threw the smoke into the tunnels, and was able to backstab one of the Epsilon players and get in a great position. Not only did he stay alive, and get a kill, but now he stayed alive, got a kill, and secured the tunnels, which means that Epsilon has to worry about doors, tunnels, and window at the same time. Great play by Dupree there.
8-4 dig. Fetish will get himself the first frag. It's going to be Kiyoshima that goes down. And another CZ round from Epsilon here. Dupree follows up on the second, and Epsilon starting to fall like flies. And for your money now, we've got three rounds left in this one. This one surely going to dig, setting us up for 9-4. Mm-hmm. How much do you think Epsilon will back their CT site? They pick this map. They've got to have something in there.
I mean, Epsilon, I've seen the dynamic CT side from them. It really depends on Shocks, though. Shocks is the type of player that if he's on fire, he'll call strats where he'll be at, you know, at the forefront. He'll be the one in the action. He'll be the one getting the kills. Right now, we see him on six frags. Is that right? Yeah, he's on six frags. He's kind of in the middle of the pack. Actually, he's second to the top fragging. It's only Kiyoshima with kills besides him. So maybe we'll see an aggressive push, but it's too early to tell. We'll have to just take it round by round. Looks like they were just doing an NOA stack there in middle, boosting on top of the head to get a kill on the Cat player. But Fetish actually pushed in through long here. So another great start for Dignitas if they fall back into their default setup.
It is Shox who was going to lead that attack, but he will retreat back. And you can see again, it just... waiting on an opening, and Dignitas giving them nothing. Mm-hmm. Every nade is just pushing them back, and Epsilon lose so much time because of this.
Exactly that. But the thing with Epsilon being at a man disadvantage right now is they're trying to get FXO to get a kill someone somewhere on the map. If he's able to equalize it into a 4-on-4, that's when Epsilon can make a move. But until then, they're kind of like at a disadvantage. No matter where they go, they're going to be kind of caught.
And with every attempt to find that frag, another 10 seconds gets eaten away.
And another smoke gets put down, which means it's another 20 seconds put away.
Suddenly, with just 30 seconds left to go, with no time for much else, they have to make the push. And when you've got Shox's aiming, it can be worth every second of the map. It's going to be Zipnix to go down. Does open us up to a 4-on-4, as the bomb will be dropped in, courtesy of him. And now Device leads the recovery. And Fetish picked off by FXO's AWP right from the center of that side. And now Shox sits waiting for anyone who dares to come up close and personal with him. Retreating with Flash was Kirishima, but Dupree getting the better of him. 3-on-2. FXO with that AWP going to play a big, big role. As Shox is downed, had little to no health and high around, and FXO had to hit that first shot, and in the end, wasn't able to, and was sandwiched down, and the bomb will be defused.
Actually, really got a good job from Epsilon actually getting into that situation in the first place. They're at a mad disadvantage. They went up onto the A-bomb site, they pushed in. Shox got the initial kill, they got the bomb planted. It was that the retake that they kind of faltered on. They lost one of the players to Device who was in CT spawn. They shouldn't have taken that peek. It was unnecessary. They had the 4-on-4, they had the bomb planted. You don't need to kind of challenge at that angle. If he hugs the far wall, or if he just like holds Cat and makes sure that they can't retake through Cat, that's all he needs to do. So some individual mistakes there, but
you were shaking your head.
I was, I don't understand. It was just, no.
Here we go. Epsilon on the last round of the half. 11-4 or 10-5 is the question. Shox will do a fair bit of damage to Zipnix, 57 in total. And they'll fancy themselves from that. That smoke, though, prevents them from getting too far. And again, you see Device. He just looks for that hit on the left and gets it. FXO, the one who's down. Now Device is flashed, but still able to go for it. Gets the first. Is there a third? You bet there is for Device. Looking for number four. Yes, hits it. And Zipnix comes in and actually took it off his toes, as GMX is now 1-on-5. And that will be a very good recovery from Dignitas to pull it back to 11-4, considering the scoreboard sat at 3-1 at one point.
That was an insane play from Device there individually. That was incredible. Just keeping his patience, playing behind the smoke, having the Epsilon players run right by him, picking up the extra two kills, and getting the assist on the fourth one. I mean, that was a great play by Device there. And
there is Device on the left side, that good-looking so-and-so.
He's handsome, if I may say so myself.
Now on this Epsilon side, 11-4 leaves very little room for error.
Yep, this is right. So. First thing they want to do is pick up this pistol round. That is the most important thing they can do at this point. Once they get the pistol round, win the next two rounds, which should be almost a given unless, you know, CZ magic happens, they can start equalizing it. 11-7, the scoreline would be, pick up the first gun round, pick up the next eco. You know, you're looking at 11-9, and everything seems to be a lot more reasonable. But it all comes down to that pistol round. It all comes down to the composure. This is their map. They chose it. They need to start pulling out some big rounds here. And actually, that last round, I saw a nice adjustment. Shrox walking out mid. They tried to do a quick mid to B. Didn't even bother about Cat. They knew Dignitas was playing that passive setup. If he had got that kill, I think they would have won. They would have reacted, gone back to A, gone A. Even if they did a B split, just smoked out CT spawn, gone B, they still could have won the round. So it's just Dignitas, their composure is just way too strong at this point.
Fetish ready to lead the way. And what was interesting on Dignitas is going into Gfinity, there was a lot of talk around the players that things weren't right at Dignitas, that they were, you know, uneasy, and that there was tension, you know, led around some breaks that Fetish had and so on. None of that showed at Gfinity. And so far, they seem to be continuing in what was a good tournament into Cologne here and the big one, the major.
I think they just keep it together when it matters most, and this is when it matters most.
Fetish leads by example. You're kind of all in or not at all. He demands 100% kind of professional approach, a full amount of time into the game. If you're not practicing, you should be.
Yeah, I think Fetish is also the one that works, I believe he works full time, so he's basically from work straight into the game.
So we are back in for the second half, and Team Dignitas are ready to leave for this as Kiyoshima will push in, and now AZ is going to go through. It'll be Kiyoshima getting himself the headshot. Dupree will be dropped. AZ's going to push forward as we spy Dignitas having to face out a very aggressive Epsilon CT side. And they push in towards these tunnels, chasing down Device. And eventually, well, I was going to say they were going to retreat, but no, they're still not conceding any ground. And Device and Zipnix will pull through. Zipnix now poking his head out of Long A, and will retreat to rejoin the party here. Now going in towards the catwalk and over towards that side. It will be Fetish who leads the charge, and from an aggressive and successful B defense, it now has led to a very open A site, which Fetish quite happily takes advantage of. And Dignitas are three men in the site to defend. Those three from B will come straight through CT spawn. They lead the way. Kiyoshima is there as well. And Device will rattle off the first few shots. There are five men in amongst that site. Zipnix gets the first frag. It shocks the Danger Man that's been down. Device only has 32 points of health as they try to defend this from Cat. As Device gets the first, GMX has gone down. Follows up with the second, but there it is. It's SF who will finish off the job despite the phenomenal play by Device. Clearing out that site, got himself three frags. And the bomb defused regardless.
Got your tongue there? That was a great play by Epsilon, a unique push actually. They came in through the upper B tunnels, they got the kills, and we just saw them playing deep in A, by the pit, by the doors, and they just played an A retake setup, and that was incredible play. They had three players with armor actually, and they just took those aim duels and they hit them. That's exactly what this team needs to do. They are a group of aimers, they need to use that to their advantage, and that's exactly what they did. They got that nice defuse going on while all their teammates were basically taking pop shots at the Dignitas players on Cat.
First frag has come from SF. Oh, what a hit from Shox. Follows up with a second. And that will be a very clean conversion from Epsilon.
And we see Shox after that round. It's like, whatever. I mean, it was Nico, granted, but I mean, those are some nice shots.
You still got to hit him.
You still got to hit him. If that was me, I would have given one shot, so. Or if it was VP.
11 to 6. Epsilon pull the first two rounds of this half back, and Dignitas will buy and will now look to announce themselves to the game. Now talk about this setup, 3 and B.
I mean, again, it's they're reading that Dignitas is going to do a B push, so they set up for it. There's no B push. They're going to kind of lock down mid, lock down B, and kind of play an A retake again. I mean, if they're that confident with their A retakes, if they have a certain way that they come back and take the bomb site, then absolutely it's a great way to kind of set up. If you're able to kind of isolate and push the terrorists back into confined location, that being Cat and the quad box there, then you can just smoke them out, nade them out, flash them out, defuse the bomb. But we're seeing actually an aggressive push here.
And AZ was waiting for it. Dropped Kiyoshima and Shox. Now pushes in, looking for the last man. It will be AZ to come charging around the corner. FX here waiting for him. But as he pokes his head out, Dupree dispatches of it. And Dignitas are now in full control of that B site. It's GMX who will try and lead the resistance as Device comes through from Sport. Dupree gets himself the first on the GMX. And this Danish Dynamite will go down, and that is just SF left standing. And, well, perfect play from AZ in the tunnels.
Yeah, that was great positioning by him. He did not get affected at all by the flashbangs because he was perfectly positioned behind that pillar. He got those two entry kills, and then he pushed into the B site. Normally, there's only two players at B. He wanted to secure the site for his teammates to come. As he threw the flashbang, he wanted to turn around from the flash so he wouldn't get blind, and that's when he spotted FXO in that corner. FXO had to take the shot. Otherwise, he was going to die. So FXO gave away his position. Had he not taken that shot, he might have been able to backstab a few players.
Shox picking up the AWP and immediately taking down his opposite number in Fetish. And that gives Epsilon the man up. And this time, they'll split that third man away from the B site.
Yeah, and if you notice what Epsilon's doing here, Shrock's got the entry kill. He made it a 5-on-4. Instead of kind of taking the same angle, he's moving around. He's keeping Dignitas guessing. They think the offset middle, he's gone somewhere else. So where is the offer going to be? Is he going to be pushing me long? Is he going to be pushing me cat? Is he going to be back at B? Is he going to be middle? Where is this offer going to be? And now they can just, Epsilon can just set up in a really defensive setup and kind of make Dignitas execute with a man disadvantage.
We look over towards that Dignitas side. They've been given no information after that frag as well. So they're looking for someone that isn't around, and they will set the attack up with Device, the bomb carrier. They have two players there to support him. In fact, they will pass that over to allow Dupree to be unleashed, and Dignitas will lead with Dupree, who jumps down. Here we go, the push is in, the smoke, still lots of players hanging amongst them, and GMX comes out the better onto Dupree. Device that goes searching for FXYO, but FXYO comes out fragging, two big hits. Zipnik's the last man up for Dignitas, does get that first kill, but he is between 1 and 3. The best he can hope for now is to be allowed to put that bomb down. The T side are not going to get there. It will be 12-7 as Epsilon get away with 3. Talking about the play, the two players stuck in the site.
So when you see, when you put two players in the bomb site, you're either fighting together or one person's fighting, the other guy's baiting. Once FXYO saw that the push was coming from Dignitas and he saw that smoke in that position, I don't know if that was his smoke or Dignitas missed a smoke or if that smoke was used to cover them from car, he hid in that smoke, kept his cool, and got two nice kills on Dignitas players who did not expect him to be there. You don't expect a second person to be on that bomb site, especially behind a smoke hiding.
Epsilon picked themselves up two frags on Dignitas' CZ round, and they will. It's Dupree making the same run that he did in the loss, but in the end with the same ending. As Fetish does get himself the kill. He's got Device for company, but also has GMX there who will get himself that kill, and Device 1-on-4. From here, we're delicately poised now. This should go to 12-8. They're 4 behind. They've got the wind in their sails. And it will be Device does get himself one more, and the AWP. This is not quite all she wrote yet, as Device is ready to dig himself in. Nowhere near that bomb, though. And so we'll just be looking to go for the elimination. He's had 45 seconds and is ready to say, well, come at me. Tosses away that AWP, make sure no one else can pick that up because he wasn't going to be able to defend his position. He knew he had to go running, and on go his Nikes, and out he goes looking for any of these remaining three players who will be happy to put him out of his misery, but at least he prevents that AWP from being grabbed.
Honestly, that was a really, really smart tactic from Device there. He knew that Epsilon players wanted to hunt him down, wanted to kill him. He was not hanging on to that AWP at all. He wanted to drop that AWP, kind of put it in a position where Epsilon couldn't pick it back up. They know that they're hurting for money, as we can see on the side here. GMX, I guess, could have afforded to buy another AWP. But at that point, it's just like, let's just go and try to get another kill. There's no way I'm winning the round. I'm probably going to die at the end of the round. I don't want to save with $0 or die at the end and have $0 afterwards. Let's just throw the AWP away and just charge at them. Great play by him, taking away some economy.
So 12-8, as we were saying before, so delicately poised now, with Epsilon fully ready to go on this CT side. Looking just desperate to win around. It would instantly force a save from the CTs, who are hurting at the moment as well. Device is going to be the man to push in, and this is the position Device was always on the other side of last round. The last half is FXYO. Ready to charge in, knows he's got an opposite number to face. Pushes down. Oh, Device with the headshot. Claims the life of FXYO.
Bit of a risky play to be doing at 12-8 scoreline. You really need to get numbers, and I guess the best player to do that is Shrox, as we just saw there, onto Fetish, equalizing it into a 4-on-4. I mean, Shrox should be the one that's making all these plays, not FXYO and Cat by himself. But we are going to see the push onto A here.
GMX is going to be the man who will see all of the action. And there's Zipnix, who goes for the first. Oh, what a hit on that man. Second goes in. Zipnix down. Great play. Jumps up and loses out to AZ and Dupree. And we're in a 2-on-2 here as the bomb is downed. And Epsilon will make their way through looking for first Dupree as the first shots come rattling up his way. But AZ gets a kill onto Shrox. The danger man down. And the follow-up is there. That will be a massive round for Team Dignitas to put into the bank.
Overextending there from Epsilon, we saw GMX getting two huge, absolutely amazing kills. What does he do? He jumps up trying to get a third kill instead of just keeping his cool, waiting for his teammates, and taking it as a 3-on-2. Instead, he dies, and then it makes it an impossible team, impossible round for his team.
How much is that easier said than done, though? The cool, I mean, of being the caster versus the heat of being, I've just hit 2 6-shots,
they
I want to go
six
for.
Shots, but, I mean, how often are you going to hit those jumping shots onto the ace bomb site?
Well, if I'm steel, I mean, you know.
If I'm steel, zero times. I have not hit that shot once in my entire life, okay? I have, like, almost 3,000 hours in this game. I've not once hit that shot.
I believe in you. 13-8, five-round difference. And a save round from Epsilon here.
Another slow start. Dignitas doesn't want to really run into a trap. I think they've read the economy situation really well.
What a hit from Fetish as SF came charging around that corner and just trying to complete the sandwich. There was one CT player pushing through the double doors, but in the end, Dignitas read it and his moment of opportunity was very quickly gone. Fetish looking for someone. Just give him a limb. Just give him something to hit. He saw a limb momentarily and he's gonna wait for it. Second bite of the cherry. Goes for the finisher. Now, oh! It was built up, Fetish. And
way to ruin it.
Yeah. And still, Dignitas will clean out the remainder of this eco round. And
Another important thing to note is not a single Dignitas player went down in that round.
14-8. No room for error now for Epsilon. And you can look at that round. If you really want to be critical, you can look at that moment where GMX did make that jump up, prevent them from coming back into that round and say, well, that could be the turning point. CS is a game that has just so few turning points. The momentum then builds off that because the money system builds or goes against you with it.
Or you can look at the before it. 14-8 was 12-8 was a score line, and FXO did that solo push on Cat when he didn't need to. That was the same round.
Yeah. Dignix gets himself the kill. Kiyoshima, though, comes in with two, and Epsilon are two men to the good here with Fetish and AZ coming through. Kiyoshima helps himself to his hat trick as Fetish is going to dispatch of him in the end, but on half health with three men to go, the best he can hope for is to somehow get that bomb down, which he does have in his backpack with that little Dignitas logo on it. He will. In here, the smoke doing his job. Dick Fetish is just completely isolated. Now going to have to go all in, try to draw out some of the Epsilon players. They're smart enough and wise to it, but don't have that second angle covered. They're all their eggs are in that double doors basket.
Epsilon's playing this smart though. They can't afford to lose another player. They can't afford to kind of fall into Fetish's bait. There's the real plant. They're going to come in together all at the same time and kind of overwhelm Fetish.
See whether Fetish can be overwhelmed. Shock picks off SF, but there is FXO. And there shall be no excitement as Epsilon pick themselves up their ninth round here.
One casualty, I mean, that's a sacrifice you have to make in order to secure the round. Sent in the player with the lowest health. Doesn't matter, Fetish has me up. He dies. Fetish's position is given away. Epsilon's able to get the kills, get the defuse, and trying to maximize their economy.
Five-round deficit, though, for Epsilon. They're going to have to go big to pull themselves back into this. Dignitas ready to make the charge. Fully naded up on the dig side.
FXO actually with the op and the nice spawn for it, too. So we're going to see what he's going to be able to do with it. Looks like nothing. That was in B tunnels, actually. We saw Shox getting that spam through the smoke, and that's how he was able to get that kill. 5-on-4 advantage. Again, Epsilon, they just need to keep this advantage. They don't need to go for any more kills. They don't want to give Dignitas a chance to get any more kills as well. So you don't want to just peek out. You want to get information, but you want Dignitas to run into your trap.
Fetish gets himself the kill onto Shox, and Dignitas now, like their chances, Zipnix follows through onto Kiyoshima, and now it's an open B site that the three from A are going to have to recover. Device is up close and personal here. As the smoke doesn't clear, he's going to get himself the next, and is firing in towards it. He will wait. Oh, GMX is going to be the only one of Device's casualties, and Epsilon know that they are going to have to save out here and go into six map points. To win this one, and FXO will go down fighting, but They will lose this round. And tough work there. Talk to us about what went on at B.
Okay, so Shroxy got the initial kill. He had a rifle. He's like, okay, I'm just going to move to the back of the B bomb site. We're just going to keep smoking off the tunnels. Now, the issue is, Dignitas, they said, all right, I think I know their setup. They're playing 2B, they're playing 3A. Let's try a mid to B right now. That's probably our best bet. Fetish went upper B tunnels by himself with the op. He was able to pick off Shroxy at the back of the platform because there's no smoke in the tunnels. Then the rest of the Dignitas players pushed up through middle, got the kill on the second B site player. They had full site control. Device sat in the CT spawn smoke, waiting for players to come through the smoke and retake. He was able to get a nice kill. I don't know if it was one or two kills. I think it was just the one. But still, it was just a great reaction from Dignitas. Great kills, and I mean, even at the advantage, Epsilon went down.
Here we go, charging in towards that B site. Dignitas want this map over with and over with fast as Device gets himself the frags onto Shroxy. Dupree will follow up with the second. They're just three frags away from taking Dust 2, which was Epsilon's map choice. They're now going to have to focus on retaking this B site. They have two coming from the gates. They have one making a long all way round through tunnels as the bomb hasn't yet gone down. It's AZU's charged with that. GMX has the job of getting in here, and if he's quick, he can catch Fetish. He is not quick, and he's going to have to go through. Know that he had the opportunity. Dupree comes from the back and drops him. Epsilon are just two men left standing. One of them is Kiyoshima. He's the only man standing, and he is going out in style. It is Dignitas who pick up a 16-9 first map victory on what was Epsilon's map choice. We move on to Inferno next, but what a half from Dignitas.
Great half from Dignitas. Their CT side was extremely strong. Got them the momentum they needed to get into the second half. Even though they dropped the pistol, they were able to keep their composure and then get the rounds, even at main disadvantages. So that's just a great just display of how good they are as a team, as a unit, as a strackler for Fetish. I mean, Fetish is doing a great job of keeping the players all basically together.
All right, we're going to throw it straight over to our analyst desk. Goots, what do you make of that?
Thank you, gentlemen. Well, I'm going to ask the fellow Frenchman, what do you make of that, MBK?
Well, that was a very good game from Dignitas. They just played a really flawless game, although their tactical side wasn't at their best, because Epsilon, I think, made some very good choices and some very good calls that Party Shroxy did. Going on a good bob site when they were terrorists. Dignitas just took advantage of all the small mistakes that Epsilon made. Dupree, Device, Fetish, you know, like getting kills left and right. And I think that was the main point here. Although they didn't have the tactical edge, they managed to win the game overall because of very strong individual plays.
Yeah, I mean, I concur with that. I do want to point out on camera, you did say Epsilon were going to win that map and I'm going to win the game 2-0. So I'm going to throw him under the bus. I'm doing it because for me, you're right about one thing. I think Epsilon had to win that map. Absolutely had to win it to have any chance to win this game. The difference, I totally agree with you, is tactical maturity and strategic points. There were so many times Epsilon resorted to the default as terrorist of sending shocks up short to try and get a pick. And when it didn't happen, they didn't win the rounds.
Well, I think that, like, they were just making individual mistakes, you know, like they went on a good spot, like they were stacked, and like I think the Epsilon playstyle is very similar to Dignitas one. But yeah, the pre getting some like several kills in the round, or Fetish with the sniper, you know, getting some entry kills, I think it makes a big difference in those matchups, you know, like at such high level of play, you capitalize on those small mistakes and that's what makes you an excellent team or, you know, just a good team.
And we saw as well in the second half when they, you know, Dignitas had to switch and play the, and we've got the stats just coming up now. And obviously Dignitas were in a position where they had to show what they could do as terrorists. And they did so many clever little things. They mixed it up really well. They had about a 50-50 between whether they went A or B, whereas Epsilon heavily favored A. I think they only went B site maybe three times in the whole half. And literally they were just constantly exerting the pressure by making the picks and just deciding where they wanted to go. It felt like they could get to any bomb site. I got to ask you this, Nathan. Shocks, again, was second in the frag charts, quite high up there. You can see the rest of his team, again, with the exception of Kiyoshima, let the team down again by not picking up the kills. But when I saw Shocks pick up the AWP and go mid in the second half, Was he doing that because that was part of his tactics, or was he doing that because he was frustrated?
No, you don't let frustration go into the game. They just plan things, and I think it's just kind of a feeling like, okay, I'm going to kill Fetish Middle because I know he's going to snipe, and I know like that's my best flick shot, you know? So he just goes with his guts pretty much, and I think Sharks is kind of a passive sniper in a way, whereas Foxer is going to take the sniper to like go up short or, you know, like try to get all the kills. And yeah, that's pretty much a feeling, I think. Knowing Sharks, like, he is just going to be like, okay, I'm going to do that because I feel it's going to be great. Because he has a very good feeling that he often has to go and get kills. But regarding Dignitas' side, you've got Device and Dupree at the top of the scoreboard.
And we were having a little discussion just off camera about whether Device or Dupree was the MVP. I was kind of feeling Device, but I know Device gets a lot of love anyway. Like, everyone raves about Device. But Dupree doesn't quite get so much attention, but he had a very solid game there. And you were going to say Dupree was your MVP.
Yeah, definitely. I think both players are extremely consistent, obviously, and Dupree in this matchup and on this too, he had on the city side those several kills that gave, like, although his team was behind in the kills, like they were 4-5, he got like two or three kills that made the team get an advantage, and then like being able to get the economy advantage. So I think for me, Dupree was very important in those crucial rounds, in those key rounds, and that's why for me, he is the MVP of the game.
And you see as well, you know, the whole of Dignitas, they were all very close to each other in terms of kills. And that's what I love again about Fetish and his role in the team. Just no ego. That round when he was just in the pit and everyone was flashing him and he just hid and he said, you know what, I'm going to let someone else get the kills. He didn't peek. He let Zipnix come and get the kills. And this is what I mean. Henrik surrounded himself with four incredibly talented players and they're all capable of fragging on their day. And that was ultimately the difference. They hit their shots and caught the kills on the rotates.
So Epsilon's choice, and they lose. You're on stage with them. You've been in that position before. What do they do to, you know, resync themselves for obviously a do or die second map for them?
Well, I think between Inferno and Dust2, Epsilon are fine with both maps. They just picked Dust2 because they probably wanted to pick the side on Inferno. So they knew pretty much that Dignitas were going to pick Inferno and then having the side on them, you know. So now it's just a brand new map. You went past Dust2, you know, you made small mistakes, but your real player were good. So you just try to pick yourself up and like, don't do the small mistakes. Like when you're in a upside advantage, when you're 5-4 or 5-3, just don't do the small peaks that are gonna make you, you know, lose the crucial rounds. And that's the only thing they have to focus on. I'm 100% sure if they play the game, they're gonna make very good tactical decisions and they can definitely take it.
Not sure I agree overall with that assessment, Nathan, and you know, you're the pro, so maybe I should. But I think I know enough about these teams and enough about these players to know Dignitas are a much more cohesive unit for me. I think they're going to cope with losing a lot better. I think that Epsilon right now, they're probably going to be thinking, well, that was our map, we've lost it, and it was probably a bad pick. Dignitas, like I say, that's, you know, 6-6, I think, now in their Dust 2. So Epsilon, I think, are going to be in a bad place going into Inferno. I think Shox is going to feel that pressure to be the star player again, and that's what's going to bring it all down for a 2-0 victory.
Yeah. Well, I'm not necessarily sure about Shox. I think he knows that he can rely on Kirishima. I mean, he's been leading now for some time, so he, like, we talked before the game, and he's just like, okay, if I want someone, I'm going to, like, Kirishima, go there and kill people, you know? Like, it's his mindset. He doesn't want to be the star player, like, just to be the star player.
Oh, I know
so
that.
It's just, I think Inferno is pretty tactical, like, a bit more than Dust2, and, like, those small mistakes can be reduced and it won't be that important. So it's going to be all those clutch situations, 3-on-3 on the bomb sites. If Epsilon can, like, turn the tables on that compared to Dust2, they can make it. But Dignitas, obviously, they are an excellent team and they're up 1-0, and once this team has confidence, they're unstoppable. So you can see players such as Dupree, Device, when they're on form, they're just making a team.
I think we saw just so many examples in that game there where Dignitas players were so calm and collected and intelligent, even when they lost rounds. You know, we saw, I think it was Device, just throw that AWP away and go and die, because he knows, I'm not going to win the round. If they get the AWP, that's going to be very bad for us. So to have that wherewithal and presence of mind, even in a crucial situation, shows how balanced they are. By contrast, we saw GMX get two kills on short in a must-win round for Epsilon, and then he jumps up trying to make a jumping frag on the site, and they just didn't have that self-control, I think.
Yeah, exactly. I think it's a lot about confidence. Dignitas, coming out of Jeff Nitti, although they had excellent games, you know, you can just see them. They look extremely confident. It's on their face. They know they have the control of the game. They're already at one map, and now they're just, okay, we're going to keep on game plan because it's working. And we're just here talking, like, being sure we're going to just go along the game plan. But look at
Henrik, though. Look at Fetish. You can just see him there, kind of in the center, just the guy in the baseball cap. If you're tuning in for the first time, that's the captain. There we go. We got a close-up on him. And this is what he does. He got the troops round. I mean, look how mean he looks there.
He
means business, right?
Man.
Look at that. Like, yeah. And he is reading them the right. This is exactly what we're going to do. You're going to do this. You're going to do that. And he's got a game plan for every situation. He is a genuine quarterback, just an amazing captain.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, Fetish is one of the greatest leaders, I think, of Counter-Strike of all times, pretty much. And the whole team looks so confident. I think it revolves a lot about Fetish because he set up all the game plan. He has the whole team under control. And you can see they are a real unit. Even on game, like, they are very calm in game. They are talking to each other, and they're clapping hands each round. You know, like, it might not mean that much, but it shows they are a real unit, and they love playing with each other, and they're just, you know, in for the game, and it works extremely well so far.
You've played with some of the people, you know, in Epsilon down the years. So, I mean, and you'll know them from the French scene and just mixing and that kind of thing. But who's the natural leader in that camp? Like, who's the guy that's going to be like Fetish and pull them all around and say we can still win this?
Well, I think on Epsilon, it has to be Sharks. I mean, he is leading the team for some time, and he brought that confidence back in Epsilon because they had, like, we talked about it before the game. At Jeff Nitti, they had some problems within the team, but now it looks like it's solved because Shoxi took the lead. And although he's not the superstar player so far, he has definitely a great psychological impact into the whole team. So he has to be the one that is, you know, bringing everyone together.
All right. Thanks, guys, for the analysis. Appreciate it. We're ready to rock and roll. Inferno. Do or die for your fellow countrymen. I hope we go to Game 3 because I'd like to have you hang out with us for a little longer.
Yeah, we'll be cool.
I know you want to go to Gamescom and get all the free goodie stuff, but we're going to keep you here as long as we can, MBK. That being said, do or die time for Epsilon. Tosspot Steel, take it away.